Radio for Readers, Bookmark.
This is Bookmark. I'm Marc Bernier. The nation's top authors are coming up next. In this edition of Bookmark, it's a chance to do two for the price of one. We met and bumped into at the Miami Book Fair Kevin Baker, who's written a book called The Big Crowd. We're going to talk about that and about the new book that you just came out about Reggie Jackson. First, The Big Crowd. This is a novel. Yeah. Tell us about this.
Yeah, The Big Crowd is a novel. It's set just after the war, for the most part, in New York City, also a little Mexico City. It's based closely on a real-life scandal. A mayor of New York who ended up basically fleeing the city from Mexico because it looked like he was going to get indicted in having a mob witness thrown out of a window.
And that's why it's called The Big Crowd.
That's what it's called. Well, it's called The Big Crowd because these are the people who were kind of running the city at that point. People who felt that he kind of go on controlling it in back rooms and clubhouses.
Okay. And how is this close to reality? What's the part that's real? Is it the fact that it's New York or the fact that it's a crazy mayor?
Oh, very, very close to reality. The mayor it's based on was a man named Lemo Dwyer. He was mayor right after the war, right after LaGuardia. He had been, before the war, the crusading district attorney in Brooklyn. And he sent most of the members of Murder Incorporated, the notorious hit mob, to the electric chair. But the big way he did it was he had a government witness, a guy named Abe Relis, who was being kept under 24-hour police guard in the separate wing out in Coney Island, 18-man police guard. And nonetheless, one night, Relis goes flying out the window. And
oh, wow.
this is something that is talked about in a lot of different things at the time. There's a reference to it in On the Waterfront, the movie, when they throw the guy off the roof. This bird could sing, but he couldn't fly. So this is a real scandal. But a couple weeks later comes Pearl Harbor. O'Dwyer, in this book, Charlie O'Kane, goes off to war, comes back something of a hero. He's elected mayor. His first wife dies. He gets remarried to the hottest fashion model in the country. Again, true story. And the society...
Why didn't you just write that story?
I know. That story is something too. But, gets married, and then these scandals start to break, and he becomes the focus of the first televised corruption investigation in American history, the Kefauver Committee hearings. And people are just fascinated. Newspapers are running ads to women saying, don't forget to keep shopping because, nobody's going out. They're all just glued to to this thing. So he becomes the focus of that, and he gets himself appointed ambassador to Mexico and goes down there with his wife. She gets more and more discontented down there. She actually takes up bullfighting. There are pictures of her in her bullfighting outfit. But the question remains, did he or didn't do it? Didn't he do it? And the story I'm telling is his much younger, idealistic brother, again, based on a real guy, Paul O'Dwyer, who was around New York politics for years, going down there and trying to get the truth from his brother. And this is, and so it's my way, the reason to do it is fiction. I can speculate on the still unsolved mob murder mystery.
Wow.
They never did solve who actually threw Abe Relis out the window. So this way I can speculate on that and what happened and give my best guess.
You went to Columbia. Did they teach you that at Columbia?
Yeah. No. It's amazing how forgotten it is. It just happened, 1950, really, when he resigned, but it's just vanished.
Let me move to the book about becoming Mr. October, Reggie Jackson. Now, did you work with him?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah,
what was he like to do the book?
Very interesting. Very interesting guy. Real good. Somebody really could have made his living as a writer, editor. Very good sense of how things read.
Well, he's no dummy. He went to Arizona State, didn't he?
Oh, yeah. He's a very smart guy.
He went to school when he was at Arizona State. I think Sal Bando was there. He played with him at the Oakland A's.
Played with all these it was a great Arizona State team. And he was terrific as a sophomore. He's already dominating. And it looks like he's going to be the number one draft pick in the country. The Mets had the draft pick. And his coach sits him down. Bobby Winkle's the great coach there.
Yeah.
Sits him down and says, bad news. The Mets are not going to draft you because you're dating a white girl. And he's saying,
are you serious?
And he's saying, what the? Among other things, I've never heard this. The woman in question, who became his first wife, was his only wife, was Hispanic. And Reggie himself, Reggie's middle name is Martinez. He's part Hispanic, you know, like what's. But this was the thing. She was, you know, he was too dark and she was too light. And so this was.
And like, the Mets passed?
So the Mets passed.
No,
so
that draft would have been what, 65, 66?
66. So he gets, you know, so he could have been on the. Think of that Mets team with Seaver and Kuzman, all those pitchers, and a real slugger.
Reggie Jackson.
You know,
and the Mets passed on Reggie Jackson.
They drafted a guy named Steve Chilcott instead, who got hurt and never played in the major leagues. So.
Okay, so how is it that the A's, are they the number two in the draft that year?
They're the number two in the draft.
Coming out of Kansas City.
Yep.
Because I think he may have ended up playing a couple of games in Kansas City.
He did. Very good. He played a few games in 67 with Kansas City. He got sent back down, and then he's in Oakland with them.
Okay, his first year, see, I followed him in the early years.
Yeah, yeah.
His first year, I guess he plays 67, 68. They're in Oakland.
Right.
And he hits like 21 home runs or something like that the first year.
Yeah, he's kind of a coming star, and then... And then 69, he has 41 home runs at the All-Star break.
Right.
And I think he's going to break.
And he got hurt?
The record. No, he just, I don't think he was hurt, but he just, you know, just went into a slump. And I think he ended up with like 47. So
somebody told me he hurt his leg.
Oh, might have. Yeah, we didn't really get it because really the book is focused on his first 2 years with the Yankees.
Okay. He's continuing to hit a ton.
Yeah.
He hits this incredible home run in an All-Star game in Detroit.
Yeah, 71. Almost hits it out of Tiger Stadium. Yeah.
And then it's the era of the free agent.
Yeah.
So he makes the leap from Oakland and Steinbrenner takes him?
Yeah, well, that's, you know, Charlie Finley had this great team. He knew
baseball.
Broke
it up for cash.
But he didn't have money, didn't have the capital. So, and it's a crazy thing. They have like MC Hammer is like this kid, and he's like the spy on the clubhouse and officially the vice president. He's like 10 years old. Crazy stuff. But he doesn't have the money to keep the team together. So he trades him first. He trades him to Baltimore. With Ken Holtzman for Don Baylor and Mike Torres.
Oh, there was a trade.
Yeah, first. Yeah,
he plays 1 year in Baltimore.
Plays 1 year in Baltimore. And he's, you know, he says he loved Baltimore, was quite willing to stay there, offered to sign with them for, I think it was $250,000 a year, which even in 1977 would have been
big money.
But I mean, relatively cheap. And they turned him down. And, you know, so instead he goes into this free agent draft. And in those days you had a, it was the first year you had to like say which free agents you were going to go after. Every team could go after like every player could be drafted by like 12 teams or something. So the Yankees are among the teams. But he's not really thinking of the Yankees getting big offers from Montreal and from San Diego. But he really wanted to go play with the Dodgers.
Okay, but he doesn't go to the Dodgers.
Dodgers very late on an offer, and George Steinbrenner just keeps pursuing him and pursuing him. You know, as you said at the time, Steinbrenner hustled him like a guy trying to hustle a girl at a bar. You know, he was just determined to sign him.
And, is it true? Was I'm trying to think if Houck was still there or whether Billy Martin was already there by the time he comes.
Billy Martin was already there. Okay. He had become the manager of the 75.
So. Does Jackson tell you that when Martin finds out that Steinbrenner is closing the deal, that Martin flips out because he doesn't want the headache?
Well, yeah, and Martin in general. Well, first of all, they wanted to sign Joe Rudy, and they wanted to sign Bobby Grich. Both, not only Martin, but also Gabe Paul, the general manager. But they both went elsewhere.
Yeah,
and people didn't really understand the value of power.
But then. this is at the time in which the commissioner of baseball steps in, because I'm at a city council meeting, reporting, and I get word that the Oakland A's, Rudy goes to the Red Sox, puts on a uniform, and then they take him back,
and Raleigh Fingers, and then they sell Vita Blue to the Yankees, and
it was just like cutting cash, and people start leaping from the team. Bando leaves and goes, I think, to Milwaukee or something.
Well, he as a free agent the next
as
year,
a free
yeah.
agent, and they're all like jumping.
Yeah,
so Jackson ends up in New York.
And he's
Wanted a candy bar named after him?
He said he wanted the candy bar named after him because he was thinking of the Baby Ruth bar, which was officially not named for Babe Ruth. They made up some excuse, but really was named for Babe Ruth. So he wanted the candy bar named after him. And no, he said, well, they said, actually, he didn't say he wanted. He said, if I played in New York, they would name a candy bar after me. So Standard Brands, I believe it is, offers him this big contract for a candy bar. And his second year in, I was at the game, opening day, home opener, 1978. You know, he'd hit the three home runs. Actually, he'd hit four home runs in the World Series on the last four pitches he'd swung at. Opening day, First pitch from Wilbur Wood. It's a three-run homer. Crowd goes nuts. First, you see one of these little red squares, kind of little orange squares, kind of flutter down from the. Then another, then another. Pretty soon, the field is just littered with thousands of these candy bars in this kind of tribute. You know, I mean, short of a bullfight, I don't think you see anything like that. You know, it's just or throwing octopuses on the ice in Detroit. You know, but it was really a unique moment.
I was at Fenway Park in a game the Red Sox played with the Yankees, in which he appears to dog it in right field and gets into a fight with Martin in the clubhouse.
That's a really interesting part of the book. He's, you know, he says he's not dogging it, and I don't think he was. He was playing deep because Jim Rice was up.
Yeah.
But Rice hit a ball off the handle and just a little squib out to right field. So he's sort of like Rice swings, you know, and then he takes too long, gets in. Didn't make a difference in the game. Rice didn't even score. But Martin, they're being pounded by the Red Sox. Martin's going nuts, and he comes out to the mound. I'm going to show him. So he takes him out, sends Paul Blair out, replaces him. And then Martin does one of his classic, you know, hold me back things where he's about to fight. You know, people are crap. But, you know, it's. Jackson says, I'm not going to fight you. But Jackson walks back to the clubhouse. An interesting thing was Bucky Dent was there. He was fed up with Martin because Martin kept pinch hitting for him. So he's already out of the game. He's about to jump the team. He's on the phone to his wife saying, come pick me up. Jackson, once he gets in the locker room, decides he's going to confront Martin. He's not going to hit him, but he's going to confront him. The guy who's like the voice of reason in all this is Fran Healy, the third string catcher.
Yeah.
He comes running in from the Fenway bullpen, goes in there, goes to Reggie, you leave. Goes to Bucky Dent, you stay. Because otherwise he'd realize this is going to be true. And he tells Reggie, you know, if you're here when he comes in, he's going to fight you. And either you're going to, you know, beat him up, which won't look good for you, or he's going to like sucker punch you, which Martin was very good at, and you're going to be humiliated. So it's just not going to end well. So you get out of there. And Reggie said, I'm not going to start a fight, but if he does try to fight, I'll kick his ass. And Bucky Dent's in the background going, kick his ass, kick his ass. You know? But he gets him to leave, so that calms the thing for the moment. You know, and it keeps coming back, but it calms everything. But, you know, you think about it. If Jackson and Dent had walked off the team and been in a fight, Martin's almost surely fired at that moment. And
But Martin gets fired like three times anyway.
Right. Martin gets fired. Well, Martin's fired the next year in 78 when he's
and then Bob Lemon comes in.
Bob Lemon comes. It's really a shame with Martin because, like, you know, he really had a serious alcohol problem.
Yeah.
And made worse by the fact that his estranged daughter had been picked up as a drug courier in Colombia. So he's getting these letters from people in Colombia saying, send money and maybe we can get your daughter out. So he's going, you know, doubly nuts. And instead of somebody sitting down and saying, Billy, you need help. We need to deal with this. We need to deal with everything. People just encourage him. You know, you're right, and that Martin, that Jackson is wrong, and but, you know, and then the Sport magazine interview comes. So it's all just keeps exploding, and finally Martin self-destructs in 1978, and he keeps coming back.
Coming back. I'm trying to remember. Martin was a manager in Oakland at one point, but Jackson was not there, correct?
No, he was a manager after he managed the Yankees. And twice, the first two times he was there. Then he goes to Oakland, and he's there for a few years. And the same thing happens, it always happened with Martin. He shakes up the team. He gets these young players playing well, and he destroys the pitching staff, and everything falls apart after a couple of years, and he's
There's
gone.
There's some weird stuff that happens in that era. Dick Williams, who was a manager for the Red Sox, had gone to Oakland.
Yeah.
There was talk of him going to Detroit. It doesn't happen.
Yeah, interesting. I didn't know.
Jackson never plays under Ralph Houk.
Right.
But he does play under some other folks. Does he play for Yogi?
And he speaks very well of all these guys. No, he didn't quite play for Yogi, but he played for Dick Williams. He played for Gene Mauch. You know, he played for, I think at the end, he played for Tony La Russa briefly.
Okay.
He played for Dick Houser, you know, and he speaks tremendously highly of all of them. But Martin, he just didn't get along with.
He gets
Earl
out
Weaver.
Of the, when does he, oh, yeah, in Baltimore.
Loved Earl Weaver. He said he.
And that tough guy to play for. Yeah. When does he finish with the Yankees?
He's finished with the Yankees. After 81, Steinbrenner feels he's done and he does not, re-sign him. And then Jackson goes and ties for the league lead in home runs the next year and comes back to Yankee Stadium and hits a home run off Guidry that wins the game. And the whole stadium stands and everybody's chanting Steinbrenner sucks, and you know.
Now, we're doing all this without notes, without a book. Who does he finish with?
He finishes with Oakland because he goes.
He goes back, Ricky Henderson. Go back five times.
Right. After the Yankees, he signs with the Angels, and then when that contract ends, he's there from like 82 through 86.
With the Angels.
And when that contract ends, then he goes and signs with Oakland for one more year. It's a 21-year major league
DH-ing
career.
DH-ing it?
Yeah, DH-ing a lot. You know, I don't think he was playing much outfield by then. But.
He had a tremendous body. Did he take steroids?
No, this is pre-steroids era. No, he's in great shape because he was a football player. And football players were all into the weights.
I mean, in a massive. I saw him hit a home run, and you could just see his back was just enormous.
And he was a football player, and he's at Arizona State, and he has a bet with a teammate. Guy says, you can't make the baseball team here. So he goes over, he says to Coach Winkles, you know, I'd like to try out. He says, okay. And he gets in there, you know, he still has his football pads on, supposedly, and he goes and, you know, hits ball after ball over the fence, and they said, you've made the baseball team.
I met him in an elevator once, and I felt like I was an 8-year-old kid.
Yeah.
And I just said, you're probably one of the best hitters I ever saw in my life. I mean, this guy could swing a bat, and he could be fast at times, too.
Great clutch hitter. Yeah, he's in Baltimore. I think he stole like 28 bases or something like this, and he missed a month of that season. He was, he didn't, you know, they didn't run that much in those days, but he could have easily been a 30-30 guy. He was, tremendous power hitter. You know, he got a lot of flack in part because he struck out a lot, and because people didn't understand what power and walks contributed in the days before sabermetrics.
But, by the time he goes to Baltimore, are the Robinsons gone, both Frank and Brooks?
Yes, they're both gone. But Ripken, Jim Palmer's still there and a few others.
Does he play with Ripken?
No, he's before Ripken. So, but he really liked the town. He liked Weaver. He really would have liked to have stayed, he said.
Good-looking guy, talented ball player. What happens to him?
Oh, he's a consultant with the Yankees now. He does a lot of appearances, does consulting, does very well for himself in that role with the Yankees.
Did he go through either a messy divorce or some child settlement or something? Legal entanglement.
He has a daughter. He was divorced a long time ago, and in good terms with the ex-wife, I think. No, I don't think there's any. I mean, this is the sort of thing for all the controversy that seems to swirl around him. By today's standards, you know, he's not somebody whoever gets he's never in a fight in a strip club. He's never, caught doing any kind of drugs. You know, I mean, he'd be considered a model citizen in many ways. You know,
he was an amazing talent, and he had good things to say about the as you write in this book. Did he like being Mr. October?
Oh, yeah. He really liked being on that stage. And he's a great description in that sixth game of the 77 World Series. And he's out there, and he said he had the greatest batting practice in his life. He's hitting last for the Yankees, and so everybody in the Dodgers are all lined up, everybody's lined up. And he said he hit like 50 balls, and he put 35 of them in this little space in the right field bleachers. And people were just standing there amazed. You know, he knew he was just locked in.
Does he answer the question as to when he stopped playing? From everything I could tell, he really wasn't done yet.
Oh,
he could still hit. The bat got a little slower, but he could still hit with power.
Yeah, I think he felt pretty done by then. We didn't really go into that as much, but I think he felt pretty done at that point. I mean, it was 21 years. He was in his 40s, so. But he's in great shape today. He's 67 years old, and I wish I was in that good shape.
Carl Yastrzemski played for the Red Sox until he was 43.
Yeah, and was pretty damn good right to the end. Terrific player.
So we have two books here. The Big Crowd.
Big Crowd.
Which in itself is a great story. This is a hidden bonus for us. Okay. And Being Mr. October.
Becoming Mr. October,
The story of Reggie Jackson. Both are out now?
Both are out in fine bookstores everywhere.
Very good. Hey, Kevin Baker, thanks for coming by to visit with us today. It's really good meeting you.
Thanks for having me.
That's Bookmark for this week. If you have comments or thoughts on future authors, send an email to us at our website, bookmark.us. That's our broadcast for today. Thanks for watching.